This video comes to you courtesy of our Patreon raffle winner, Indiscreet One. And if you too would like your idea for a Media Mementos video to come to life, then stay tuned to the end of the video and I'll tell you how. You know what I just thought of recently? And by recently, I mean when I wrote this script, February 19th, 2022. Batman is quite the special superhero when it comes to his movies. With other superheroes like Spider-Man or Superman or whatever this is, a lot of their movies can be fairly divisive. Take for example Superman 3. This has some very split opinions. Some say that the comedic tone was a welcome change of pace, while others say that Richard Pryor had no business being in a Superman film. Then there's the two amazing Spider-Man films, which have people either loving them or hating their guts. And speaking of Spider-Man, there's Spider-Man 3. This one especially seems to have the love-it-or-hate-it culture around it, and I want nothing to do with it, so I'll let you hash it out in the comments as to whether it's good or bad. On the other hand, Batman doesn't seem to have this issue. There seems to be this universal opinion as to which of his films are good and bad. For example, everybody seems to love Mask of the Phantasm, Batman 1989, and The Dark Knight, while everyone seems to hate Batman and Robin, The Killing Joke, and The Dark Knight Rises. But today, I'm gonna have to be that guy. There's one Batman film that I don't agree with the common consensus on. In fact, while I would still say that this movie's bad, I wouldn't really say it's that bad. The film in question is the previously mentioned Batman and Robin. This film came out in the late 1990s and almost killed Batman's cinematic career. It was so hated, in fact, that the fifth film, Batman Triumphant, was canceled so that they wouldn't have a repeat of the mess that this film caused, and personally speaking, I'm really upset. Not only were they gonna get a lot darker going back to the 1989 roots, but the Scarecrow, my favorite Batman villain of all time, was gonna be the main villain. Not only that, but he was gonna be played by Steve Buscemi. That's some ideal casting right there, but we'll never get to see it. I liked Batman Begins and all, but I hated the Scarecrow in it. That's not the Scarecrow, that's Sackboy! Here's the majority opinion on the first four Batman films. Batman 1989 is fantastic, Batman Returns is great, Batman Forever is eh, and Batman and Robin is one of the worst things ever created by humanity. On the other hand, here's my opinion. Batman 1989 is fantastic, Batman Returns is even better, Batman Forever is really bad, and Batman and Robin is regular bad. Notice the difference here?
Shut up and get to the point!
That's right, in case you couldn't read the title, I'm gonna explain to you why I believe Batman Forever is worse than Batman and Robin. And if you don't agree with me, then too bad, you're wrong! I'm kidding. If you don't agree with me, that's just fine. This is my opinion, this is purely the way I see it, and I'm trying to explain my piece. If you disagree, alright, comment below and let me know why you disagree, and we can have a fun civil discussion. If that even exists on the internet. And now, back to the video. So, we're going to be looking at these films in two ways. As Batman movies, and as movies on their own. First, as Batman movies. George Clooney's an alright Bruce Wayne, but he's a terrible Batman. He's got the opposite problem that Christian Bale had in the Dark Knight trilogy, where he tries a bit too hard to make Batman and Bruce Wayne different from each other. George Clooney doesn't do that at all. In fact, aside from the costume, they're the same character, and that's not how it's supposed to be. He could walk into a room and say, "Hi, I'm Bruce Wayne," or, "Hi, I'm Batman." And if I wasn't looking at the screen, I wouldn't be able to tell if he was being honest. Val Kilmer, on the other hand, does a good job as both Batman and Bruce Wayne. He's no Michael Keaton, of course, but for a replacement, I think he does a good job. So that's score one for Batman Forever. And spoiler alert, that's probably the last battle it'll win over Batman and Robin. Robin is the same in both films. Yep, Batman Forever introduced Robin.
Yay, everyone wanted that.
Although, I will say that I'm happy that in both films, they aged him up. Instead of a whiny teenager, Robin's a whiny adult pretending to be a teenager, so automatically it's better. But then we get to the villains. Uma Thurman, playing the role of Poison Ivy, doesn't do that bad of a job. It's a bit over the top, sure, but as far as acting goes, she does her job just fine. They stick to her comic book roots and give her a little bit of a theatrical edge to help set her apart from the other versions of the character. And then there's Arnold Schwarzenegger as Mr. Freeze, and he's definitely unique. I can say that giving him the role was most certainly a choice that was made. Personally, if it were up to me, I would have gone for Patrick Stewart in this role, but I guess they wanted someone a bit more bombastic and out of the norm. And I'll give them credit, that's definitely what Schwarzenegger brought. So, a little bit of context for Mr. Freeze. Before Batman the Animated Series came out, Mr. Freeze was one of the most basic villains that Batman had. He was just a guy with an ice gun and nothing else. But then Batman the Animated Series came around and changed the whole Batman game. Not only did it create a bunch of original, now fan-favorite characters like Harley Quinn, but it also took to reinventing some of the more one-dimensional characters and giving them some depth. One of the most famous ones was Mr. Freeze. Now, he was a scientist whose wife was diagnosed with an incurable disease, so Mr. Freeze froze her until he could find a cure. But as tends to happen with Batman villains, a tragic accident ensues, and now he's not able to survive if he's not in a sub-zero temperature. So his goal is to freeze the world so he and his wife could live their life once again. The writers of Batman and Robin clearly knew how powerful this was, so they lifted it and put it in their film. Even so, they make the character, silly. There's no other word for it, he's just a giant clown. Even when he mourns his wife, he's a giant goofball. And honestly, I can't get enough. Yeah, the ice puns are a weird choice, and he says like, what, 24 in this film? Yeah, Schwarzenegger isn't really that convincing as Mr. Freeze, but he's still a lot of fun. He's easily the most recognizable and memorable part of this movie. But that begs the question, why is Mr. Freeze like this, or for that matter, why is the rest of the film just like him? Loud, crazy, colorful, explosive, cartoonish. Two reasons. One, Batman Returns. When this film came out, a lot of people, especially corporations, weren't exactly happy with the dark tone that it took. That's actually one of the reasons why Batman Forever became as lighthearted as it is. More on that later. But then Batman and Robin went in the opposite direction that Batman Returns did. Where Batman Returns was too dark and too scary, Batman and Robin was too corny and over the top. And then secondly, a lot less of a depressing reason, Batman and Robin is effectively an homage to the 1960s show. Think about it. The dialogue is corny, the action scenes are strange, it's bright and colorful, the guy who plays Batman doesn't really work at distinguishing Batman and Bruce Wayne, and it's rooted into the cheesy comics of the day. That's Batman and Robin's vision. It wants to be like these old comics and the old show, and it goes all out. It doesn't compromise on the vision one bit. Sure, you could argue that it goes a little too far in trying to recreate this, and I would agree, but on the whole, it throws back to a simpler time. And if you ask me, it actually fits right at home with some of the superhero films we see today. Like Ant-Man Quantumania or Thor Love and Thunder. Over-the-top films with corny dialogue that don't know how to pick their moments. Now, of course, they're not exactly like Batman and Robin. For one, they're significantly more competent. But you can't really say that the kind of thing Batman and Robin is trying to do is unheard of, especially today. As a Batman film, Batman and Robin is definitely Batman and Robin. It's got some strong roots to the source material, even if it's not everybody's favorite part of the source material. It gets most of the characters right. Looking at you, Bane, I am so, so sorry. So you can say it's a relatively faithful adaptation, but with that being said, that's also one of the best aspects of adapting a comic book. Because there's a lot of iterations of the character, all you really have to do is follow the common structure that the character shares throughout the years, and then you have plenty of room to add details of your own. How are you going to make this character different from all the other versions? They do this pretty well in Batman and Robin with Poison Ivy and Mr. Freeze, but Bane, no. They reduce him to being Poison Ivy's generic henchman, and all he really says are, "Ugh!" and, "Ugh!" Plus, he's only got about 10 minutes of screen time and amounts to nothing. But as far as I'm concerned, he's the only major character misstep that the film has. Everyone else is portrayed well, has their own unique spin that still fits in line with the character, or is just miscast. Clooney! But in defense of Bane, at least they're not messing up one of the most famous and most beloved characters in all of Batman, like, I don't know, Two-Face for one. Now, who would do such a thing like that? Oh yeah, that's right. Batman Forever. Batman Forever is a bad, bad Batman movie. We've already talked about Batman and Robin, not the movie, the characters. So let's move on to the new characters, the villains. These guys are awful. Let's start with the Riddler, played by Jim Carrey. Firstly, I'll be fully honest here, I'm still bitter that they didn't get Robin Williams as originally planned, but still. I love Jim Carrey. I think he's a great comedic and dramatic actor. Whether it be The Mask, Dumb and Dumber, Dodgeball, The Truman Show, or even Sonic the Hedgehog, he's proven time and time again that he's a smoking good actor with some of the best timing in the industry. But he really missed the mark here. Before Batman the Animated Series helped solidify the Riddler as an intellectual egomaniac who always has to prove his superiority, there were a lot of other versions floating around. One of those versions was a wacky screwball who was very similar to the Joker, but instead of being like a clown, he would use riddles to tell Batman what he was about to do. While I personally think that the egomaniac version of the Riddler is the superior one, I think that the wild and wacky one can still work given the right writing. Plus, you got Jim Carrey here, and you kind of have to make him the screwball version of the Riddler. It'd be kind of weird to see him be the other version, you know? So how do they decide to make the character interesting or distinct from other versions? Answer, they don't. They just put Jim Carrey in silly-looking spandex and let the camera roll. All this is Jim Carrey doing his best Jim Carrey impression and nothing else. He doesn't have the charm or the out-of-place nature that Arnold Schwarzenegger does, and he doesn't have the composed corniness that Poison Ivy does. Instead, it's Jim Carrey at his worst. It feels like the writers only thought that Jim Carrey was a funny comedian because he was rubber-faced. So they have him mug for the camera constantly and say silly things in an over-the-top voice, and it ends up being not funny, not intimidating as a villain, but really annoying. See, even with Schwarzenegger, who was essentially the comedic relief villain of that film, there were still times where he dialed down the craziness. He was always a live-action cartoon, of course, but there were still times where he could be quiet and let his character build. Jim Carrey's Riddler doesn't have that, so the character isn't allowed to grow. Instead, it's the most surface-level representation of the Riddler that I've ever seen. So when I'm watching him, I only ever feel like I'm watching Jim Carrey, not Edward Nygma, and not the Riddler. And as a result, I feel like the character's been dealt a really big disservice. But it could be worse. At least it's not as bad as the Joker in this film. What? No, that's not Two-Face, that's the Joker. I mean, look at him! He's running around, he's giggling, he's dancing. That's the Joker! I do like the attention to detail, though, that he's all scarred and deformed after his first fight with Batman in 1989. That's Two-Face? Really? And that's Tommy Lee Jones? Really? Okay, so this is Two-Face. We all know Two-Face, right? Harvey Dent, Gotham City's district attorney, who one day went crazy and is now the crime boss Two-Face. He decides people's fates with the flip of a coin, and he never disobeys it, no matter what. Unlike, say, the Joker or the Riddler, Two-Face is supposed to be a stoic and troubled individual, but in this film, they don't show that at all. Instead, it's just another Jim Carrey, but this time he's not played by Jim Carrey. All the backstory with Harvey Dent getting attacked, and his mental troubles and his friends and family, all gone. They don't mention it once. They also turn the coin thing into just a gimmick, with him constantly flipping around on the coin to get a result that he wants, and as soon as he does, then he can finally act. I'm not sure if this is true, but word has it that Tommy Lee Jones played the character this way so that he could spite Jim Carrey, because apparently he thought he was annoying. But even if that's true, that does not justify the way the script treats Two-Face. He's just another loud, colorful clown. It's as if they wanted the Joker again, but Jack Nicholson wouldn't come back. So let's just make him Two-Face instead. And that's a real shame because, as we're going to discuss a little bit later, Two-Face's story would have been perfect for the themes that Batman Forever tries to present. Then they also wasted a whole bunch of potential that, thankfully, The Dark Knight got right years later. And I know that earlier I said that a comic book character can change in various adaptations, but I also said that they had to stay true to the basic traits that were never to be broken. And Two-Face doesn't do that here. In fact, he has none of the traits that Two-Face is supposed to have. So that's how Batman Forever treats its villains, huh? Alright. Well, I think I've made the case that Batman and Robin's a better Batman film than Batman Forever. But how's about films on their own? Which one is better? I'd still say Batman and Robin. First, let me talk about Batman Forever. It tries to bring up a lot of complex themes like, who is Bruce Wayne? Is he starting to lose his identity when he takes on the role of Batman? And even if he's one of them now, will he always be that way forever? And those are some interesting ideas, but they don't go all the way. Batman Forever tries to have its cake and eat it too. It wants to have some of that darkness from 1989 and Returns, but it also wants to be more kid-friendly and more appeasing to the corporate overlords. So what does it do? Does it find a nice middle ground that can satisfy both parties? Nope. In one scene it'll be one way, and in another scene it'll be the other. A constant mishmash of conflicting tones, and it makes the whole thing a really choppy experience. In one scene we'll have Batman pondering his existence, or Robin trying to cope with the death of his family, and then in the next scene we have, "Hi kids, I'm Two-Face Joker, whee!" It kinda reminds me how in Spider-Man 3 there's that ridiculous dance scene, and then it ends with Peter hitting Mary Jane and then contemplating his existence. These things don't match. So imagine that, but stretch it out to a whole feature-length film runtime. And this is really frustrating because the serious stuff in Batman Forever is honestly pretty good. I like the style that it goes for, and I like the themes that it presents. But firstly, the drama is ruined by the constant quote-unquote comedy. But also because they're dividing their attention to both parts of the film in half, both visions end up half-baked. The comedy is just screaming and really annoying banter. And then the serious stuff doesn't go far enough. Like I was saying earlier, Two-Face would have fit perfectly into the themes that they were trying to present. Who is he really? Is he Two-Face, or is there still some Harvey Dent deep down inside? And considering that in most versions of the comics, Harvey Dent is one of Bruce Wayne's best friends, this could have amplified what Bruce was going through, and maybe he could have tried to go through this crisis with a friend who was going through the same thing, or be tortured by the fact that someone else is having this same problem, but he's too far gone at this point, so what does this mean for him? But instead, we get character development that's inconsistent and unfinished, and severe tonal whiplash for 120 minutes. This is a personal thing for me, but it drives me crazy when a film is so close to being good, but it keeps shoehorning elements into it that bring the whole thing down. That's why I believe that Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince is the worst of the Harry Potter films, because unlike Goblet of Fire, which is just a mess in general, this had a lot of good to it, so it makes the bad parts that much worse. You can see a good movie trying to break out, but you know that it never will, no matter how many times you watch the movie again and again, hoping it changes. To show you how this could be done right, let's compare this to a similar film in concept, Spider-Man 2 with Tobey Maguire. Spider-Man 2, just like Batman Forever, has several serious moments, but also has a lot of this. The reason this works in Spider-Man 2 and not in Batman Forever is because in Spider-Man 2, these two styles work together. They're not competing for dominance, and they don't feel like two separate visions stapled together. It's just a comic book-esque action film with some grounding in reality. Batman and Robin, on the other hand, has a consistent vision, goofiness. And for what it's worth, it accomplishes that. It's meant to give the audience a sense of fun and excitement, and if you can turn your brain off, it can provide it. You can't really do the same with Batman Forever when it has those story scenes. So right away, Batman and Robin is a lot easier to watch. Is it well written? Not particularly, but is it aware of it? I'd argue yes. As I mentioned before, it's trying to harken back to the days of Silver Age cheesy comics. This is a pretty good representation of them. Everything from the costumes, the gadgets, and even the scenery all feel like they've jumped right off the pages of a classic era comic. For better or worse. This film was infamously directed by Joel Schumacher, who has a lot of musical movies under his belt, most notably Phantom of the Opera and The Wiz. So he brought that theatrical musical experience to Batman. All without the music. It gives the film some distinction, and honestly, it's pretty fun to look at. That, and since it has a consistent tone and vision, it makes for a much more cohesive experience. Now, is this whole throwback to the old era of comics thing for everybody? Absolutely not. In fact, I'd say it's pretty niche. But at least it has a niche. The niche for broken films with inconsistent pacing and styles is considerably smaller, to say the least. When I'm watching Batman and Robin, I just have fun. When I'm watching Batman Forever, I get frustrated. Whereas Batman and Robin is good campy fun, Batman Forever tries to be both good campy fun and dark and brooding, and it fails at both. And then as Batman films, one is trying to pay homage to a specific era in time, and the other is a mess. So yeah, you can disagree with me if you'd like, that's just fine, but at the end of the day, you now know why I believe that Batman Forever is worse than Batman and Robin. Well folks, thanks for watching the video, what'd you guys think? What's your favorite of these two films, and what's your favorite Batman film in general? And also, who's your favorite Batman villain? Please say the Scarecrow, you'll be my friend if you do. Comment below and let me know, because I'm always excited to hear what you guys have to say. And now, it's time to thank our wonderful Patreon people, starting with our Masters of Fate. Chan 11, Diego V, Kev Messick, Manny Paredes, MD the Dude, Ryan Williams, Timey, and Woody Woo. And now, our executive producers, Aaron Vasquez, Albert Robinson, Blackjack, Edward Haas, H.R. Huffman, I Am Vove, Indiscreet One, Ravioli Supremo, Unkale, Who Else But Zane, and YouTube Milkwad. If you too would like your name read at the end of every Media Mementos video, then why not donate to the Patreon? There's a link in the description below for you to check out. And there's also a link to the Media Mementos Discord server, so why not pop in and say hi? Alright folks, thanks for watching the video, and I'll see you guys next time. Take care.